65,000. To throw the bomb. He's looking for AC. Anthony's got it.
Listen to the roar of the crowd here at the Silverdome. We're going to Denver.
Flying high. The story of the 1983 Michigan Panthers.
The Michigan Panthers at 11 o'clock this morning made their first draft choice, and it's Dave Greenwood, who's a defensive back from the University of Wisconsin.
Greenwood, of course, is a great athlete. We're very pleased to get him. I think he could play corner as well as safety because he doesn't take any wrong steps. He's a great athlete and a smart kid.
The Michigan Panthers were off and running and quickly drafted a quarterback from Northwest Louisiana who promised to keep them in the race. Bobby Hebert, a kid with a baby face and a slingshot arm. Tulsa's Ken Lacy was a knockout who lasted till the sixth round, despite gaining nearly 1,100 yards in his senior year. And to give the backfield a potent 1-2 punch, the Panthers nabbed Wisconsin's John Williams and his big play reputation. To further spice up the offense, they drafted Derek Holloway, a 5'7" wide receiver from Arkansas, whose back had become a familiar sight to Southwest Conference opponents. And just in case one deep threat wasn't enough, Anthony Carter, already a Michigan legend from his college days, was a territorial choice who offered the Panthers a surefire way to fly past their opponents. The picture was complete. The Panthers had signed more of their draft choices than any other USFL team, and their inaugural season took flight on a Monday night in the Deep South. Meeting the Birmingham Stallions on their own turf seemed like a difficult first challenge, but the Panthers were ready to stalk their prey. Ray Bentley, a rookie linebacker from Central Michigan, started with a bang, hitting up the home team for two interceptions and leading a defensive charge that held Birmingham to 7 points. Raleigh Dutch's Stallions kept Michigan out of the end zone altogether, but the Panthers showed another way to get what they wanted. Novo Bojovic, a Central Michigan teammate of Bentley's, and another rookie kicked two 49-yard field goals, then added a 48-yarder, giving the visitors a 9-7 victory. The kicker had held up his end, and the Panther fans learned they could count on Novo.
I'm going for less, nothing but the best. That's it.
He came from Yugoslavia, a superstitious youngster with a clove of garlic in his sock and a cannon for a foot. Panther fans loved to watch him kick, but they liked his reactions even more. He was just so excitable.
Well, he's just an excitable boy.
Three weeks later, Novo kicked a last-second field goal and forced an overtime with the Washington Federals. But things had begun to go wrong for the Panthers, and the Feds went on to win. The Panthers knew they had all the main ingredients they needed to contend, yet found themselves in the throes of a four-game losing streak.
Everybody plays the fool sometimes. There's no exception to the rule.
Ability to reason.
times were tough, but the Panthers were sticking together, confident that better days lay ahead. And one Panther in particular was making a name for himself, linebacker John Corker, who never let quarterback slip through his hands. He quickly became known as Sackman, and when the losing streak ended against New Jersey, much of the reason was a record-setting performance by the toughest linebacker in the league.
Anything you can do, I can do. It's better. I'm the toughest. And I can do what you can't do. You never try to do what I do. I'm the toughest.
I'm the toughest.
And I say anything you can do, I can do it better. I'm the toughest. I'm the toughest. And I can do what you can't do. You never try to do what I do. I'm the toughest.
The Panthers were discovering the Central Division was the toughest, and they decided they needed help up front if they were to get in front. Tackle Ray Pinney came on board, as did former Pittsburgh teammate, guard Tom Dornbrook, and yet another former Steeler, guard Tyrone McGriff. When those three joined tackle Chris Godfrey and rookie center Wayne Radloff, most figured the Panthers had assembled the league's best offensive line. The skill positions had already looked strong, and now they had room to move. And when Bobby Hebert dropped back, he had time on his hands. They were an imposing sight for USFL defenders, and among the main beneficiaries were the running backs. Number 28, Ken Lacy, moved toward the top of the rushing leaders. Number 40, John Williams, became their top touchdown threat. And Cleo Miller flashed the form that made him an NFL standout. For the backfield, it was ready, set, go. Panthers were bridging the gap. Michigan took a three-game winning streak to Boston in week 9, and suddenly everything seemed to be going the Panthers' way. And in the middle of the recovery was quarterback Bobby Hebert. The Hebert arsenal included an ability to scramble, an ability to throw short to tight ends like Mike Cobb, and when the situation called for it, an ability to bomb away. Anthony Carter was also coming into his own, and his fourth quarter catch gave the Panthers a 21-10 lead. Dick Corey's breakers were held to just 65 yards on the ground in this game, but ageless Boston quarterback Johnny Walton was having a field day and bringing the breakers back with two late touchdowns. Suddenly, the Panthers were down, and it was double take time for Jim Stanley. But with a minute 23 to play, John Williams broke into the end zone vault and recovered the stolen lead from Boston. Corey unleashed his attack one more time, and the Walton ended up with 423 passing yards. Time simply ran out for the Breakers. The winning streak was up to four. And after a win in Arizona, the Panthers returned home to meet Chuck Fairbanks, the New Jersey Generals, and the USFL's best-known player. Herschel Walker was living up to his reputation as a runner, and he helped the Generals bolt out to a 17-3 halftime lead. But the Michigan Panthers had a coming of age in the second half. Hebert was in the midst of his fourth straight game without an interception, and the Panthers began to clear one hurdle after another. Hebert completed more than two-thirds of his passes, and Anthony Carter had his second straight 100-yard game. The Panthers now seemed to believe anything was possible. And after three second-half touchdowns by Williams, the last with 3:43 to play, their faith was rewarded. The word was spreading. Michigan's wide-open style was lighting up the Silverdome, and Panther fans were getting excited.
Tonight we're gonna make it happen. Tonight we'll put all of the things aside. Give in this time and show me some affection. We're going for those pleasures in the night. I'm so excited, and I just can't hide it. I'm about to lose control, and I think I like it. I'm so excited, and I just can't hide it. And I know I want you.
Next up was another hot Central Division team, the Birmingham Stallions, who promptly ended Hebert's streak of avoiding theft. The plays that had been going the Panthers' way were suddenly going the other way, and there was no explanation. Hebert managed to stir up a comeback, but when push came to shove, an extra point attempt was blocked by the Stallions, forcing an overtime period. Finally, Scott Norwood's 46-yard field goal lifted Birmingham to a 23-20 victory and ended the Panthers' six-game winning streak. The win was the fifth straight for Birmingham and will always be remembered for one very unusual play.
Smith wide to the right side, Frederick, and Anderson wide left. Quarterback Lane to throw, sets up at the midfield, going to the long, into the end zone with a pass, intercepted by Michigan! Picked up by Birmingham for a touchdown. Picked up by Darryl Mason. Can you believe it? Logan wearing the goat horns.
How can anybody believe that play? He thought his momentum carrying back in the end zone, and he stood up. He thought, well, I caught this ball in the end zone, was doing a dance, and you wonder why Tom Landry's told his team that he can't spike the ball anymore? Fred Logan was down on the one-yard line when he came up, that somebody evidently had touched him. He was down, the ball's dead, the play stops. That's a hard, I don't know.
Eager to put the whole Birmingham fiasco behind them, the Panthers roared out for a battle with division-leading Tampa Bay the following week. And having lost to the Bandits earlier, they were out for revenge. The Bandits tried three different quarterbacks, but this was Michigan's night to jam that loss back at them.
All right, we're jamming. I wanna jam it with you. We're jamming, jamming. And I hope you like jamming too. Ain't no rules, ain't no vow. We can do it anyhow. I and I will see you through. Cause every day we pay the price, we're the living sacrifice. We're jamming till the jam is through. We're jamming. The thing we're jamming was
just a thing of the past. Good jumping, and I hope this time is gonna last. No bullet to stop us now. We need to beg, no, we won't bow. Neither can be born our soul. Right, that your children must unite. Your life is worth much more than gold. We're jamming,
jamming, jamming, jamming,
and we're jamming in the name of the Lord.
We're jamming,
jamming, jamming, jamming,
jamming right straight from your.
The game was the second most one-sided of the season, and the people responsible for the air attack were becoming familiar faces. There was the rookie quarterback with the poise of a veteran, and the rookie wide receiver with the cat-like moves. There was the other rookie wide receiver, the one with the small frame and an affinity for the big play. And finally, there was the veteran tight end, the most consistent of all the Panther receivers. Hebert, Carter, Holloway, Cobb were all were soaring, but the challenges weren't getting any easier. Philadelphia coach Jim Mora was already on the verge of locking up the Atlantic Division title, while Stanley was still stuck in third place. Corker had his eyes on the quarterback, but the Panthers fell prey to a running back named Kelvin Bryant, whose rise to stardom had been meteoric. Trailed, but were controlling the ball, and Hebert was again proving that as a poised rookie, he was untouchable. The lead seesawed, and Mora turned his quarterback loose. Chuck Fusina threw more than he had all season, and the biggest of his passes went to Booker Russell. The Panthers gained more yards and held the ball longer, but couldn't outrun a few key mistakes. They had met the team many considered the best in the league and were able to find some consolation in the fact that though they had been outscored, they hadn't been outplayed. And as the final four approached, the Panthers knew outplaying their opponents wouldn't be enough. To make the playoffs, they'd probably have to win all four. And the trip began in L.A. The cast of characters was expanding, and Terry Miller added his considerable talents to the attack. But there was still a long way to go, and against L.A., Hebert again showed an imaginative style and a delicate touch, throwing four touchdown passes, one to tackle-turned-tight end Ray Pinney. Once again, recovery was just around the corner, and it was Corker who provided the finishing touches. Back home, the Panthers focused on the league's losingest team. And with a chance to move into a second-place tie, they started with a bang. Anthony Carter's fourth touchdown in five games gave them a first-quarter lead. But while the Panthers came at Washington from every direction, they just couldn't seem to pull away. It finally took a Novo Bojovic field goal with less than a minute to play to settle it. With a crack and a share of first place, the Panthers then settled into scorching Soldier's Field, but had been prepared by trainer Jay Shoup's week-long hydration program. Field temperatures reached 134 degrees, and the Panthers used 1,000 pounds of ice to stay cool while keeping the heat on quarterback Bobby Scott. Cornerback Clarence Chapman proved he could take it on the chin and still keep his chin up about it. And all day long, the entire Michigan defense kept the blitz under wraps. While offensively, Hebert put on a quarterback clinic. Holloway caught two touchdown passes, and the pounding of the blitz also included two long TDs to Anthony Carter. It was a record-setting five-touchdown performance by Hebert and a remarkably easy win. The head-spinning Panthers were now a win away from a championship and not about to let the Wranglers stand in their way. Ken Lacy proved he'd been watching closely all the times that Hebert threw to Holloway and showed that given the chance, he could do it too. Two minutes and 36 seconds into the game, the tone had already been set, and the Silverdome crowd witnessed an onslaught that didn't stop until the fourth quarter, when John Williams scored the Panthers' last regular season touchdown. And after 11 wins in 13 games, owner Alfred Topman and Coach Stanley had a divisional champion. It had been a season of memorable images. They staggered in the early part, but recovered. And when playoff time arrived, the Michigan Panthers were still standing.
You can never know what it's like. Your blood like winter freezes just like ice. And there's a cold and lonely light that shines from you. You wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing. 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 I'm still standing.
What do you think about the Panthers?
Yeah. Look at go all the way to Denver. Take it all. Take it all. Panthers are number one.
Still hungry, a league record 60,000 plus turned out to witness the playoff strategy.
You know, offensive linemen, we just got to practice hard, run block, pass block, and if we do that, you know, I think we can win.
Williams struck first, and the defense prepared to keep Oakland from driving.
Well, I think Raymond Chester, Whittington, and Bassano are the three key people in the offense, and we would have to do a good job to stop them.
The hitmen were executing, and when the invaders from the west were repelled, the hometown offense got plenty of chance to show that it too had absorbed the game plan. And Anthony Carter's forward progress was good for 6 points. And when things bogged down a bit, Ken Lacey showed some impressive lateral movement in the direction of John Williams. Hebert seemed to have a plan for every occasion, and though he tried to counter, Oakland coach John Ralston was a profile in futility. Lacey found another big hole to climb through, and as the lead grew, so did the size of the hands in the Silver Dome. When Oakland's last-ditch effort was snared by the good hands of David Greenwood, the message was loud and clear. After another big romp, the Panthers were headed for the championship game.
It was like a madhouse. They played us tough, but luckily we came out with the win.
Philly, watch out.
Well, I'm just glad we came out on top, and it's one of the greatest feelings I ever had in my life. And, you know, I'm just glad we won.
You looked out there the first week of competition. We're opening up. You see 21,000 fans, but to come out and see 60,000 screaming people, I mean, it was just extra drilling, I tell you.
Last week was big, this week is bigger, next week is going to be bigger. We're going to win it all. We got some great veterans. I'm just happier than hell for everybody here.
Oh, yeah, it was a great game, and I'm just glad that we came out on top.
Boy, you really came through. I'm really proud of you. And, you know, we said we had two. There's one more to go.
That once obscure object of desire, the first USFL championship, was now very much within reach. And the historic sights and sounds of the first USFL championship game were about to be displayed. The Panthers had come a long way, but there remained one more challenge to overcome. The attention given Bobby Hebert continued to grow, but the 22-year-old seemed unperturbed and gave Michigan the lead by finding Derek Holloway, who had been left completely alone. Corker was also a center of attention, and he too was living up to his reputation. Stanley's Panthers were in command, and as the battle lines were drawn, once again it was the smallest man on the field who made the big play. Holloway put away his second touchdown, putting Philly 14 behind and convincing Urban Johnson that the Panther magic was working again. Jim Mora's Philadelphia Stars had recovered from a 21-point deficit in the fourth quarter the week before, and Willie Collier's fourth quarter touchdown forced Jim Stanley to make some adjustments. The lead was suddenly tenuous, but the Panthers thought they knew what was coming. The call was split right, A44 pass, corner two. Carter was ready to run a sideline pattern, but the Stars were blitzing, exactly as the Panthers had predicted. So by the time safety Mike Lush reached the line of scrimmage, Michigan had a different play in mind. Noticing single coverage on Carter, Hebert audibled, and AC took off on a square out pattern. With a big block by Holloway, Carter went in untouched, and gave the Panthers a 10-point lead with only 3:01 to play. For Anthony, it was the ninth catch of the game, giving him a whopping 179 yards. And for Michigan, it was the play of the year. Though Philadelphia scored again as time ran out, the Panthers were on their way to victory. The comeback was complete, and they were celebrating the state's first major pro sports championship in 15 years. Owners Alfred Todman and Max Fisher had made a commitment to excellence and could now rejoice in Michigan's dream come true.
United States Football League champions!
That's right, we love you. We're bringing it back home.
Hershey got more yards than I did. Kelvin got more yards than I did. But I got the ring.
You know, we've come from a long way. You know, and it's just a tribute to the ownership, the coaches, and the players.
We back! We back! One and four! We all the way in the dome!
All the way, baby!
We're proud to be able to bring this trophy back to the city of Detroit.
The game's MVP, miracle-working Bobby Hebert.
Yeah, we were a lot of young players. We were probably one of the youngest teams in the USFL when we started out. And, you know, we just stuck together. You know, the teams wrote us off, and the fans, we were 1-4, but they came back and we started winning. And, you know, I'm this guy who won the championship.
You know, I was thinking, he's so young, we're just out of college. It just seems impossible, but I think it's great.
Most certainly was the year of the new excitement for the state of Michigan. Of the 12 United States Football League teams, the Panthers flew highest of all. Just around the corner is the 1984 season, and for Panther fans everywhere, the excitement is back again.
Flying high on the feeling. Flying high on your love.